Tram tangle akrat in yunuth. Te kakathani thilothuth.
Oh, Peter. How many of you can relate with Peter from time to time? Oh, man, he's one of those guys that as you read through scripture, you could just relate with him, but you kind of cringe relate with him, right? Because you're like, oh, man, what? Did you really just cut his ear off? Like, right? He's one of these in scripture who is just so very real. And unfortunately, there's a lot of the time where we see the good things in Peter, where Jesus calls out something magnificent that he sees in him. And we're like, all right, Peter, way to go. You pulled it off. You did it, right? And then there are other times like this moment in Peter's life where he just like, okay. And we'd like to think in this moment, I'm like Peter sometimes, but I wouldn't have done that, right? I don't know if any of you have ever felt like me, that just kind of in your quiet moments of pride where you're just thinking to yourself of how great a Christian you are, of like, at least I'm not like Peter. One of the most common questions that I get in kids' church from the children is, why did Adam have to sin? Because if Adam didn't sin, then we wouldn't have to sin, right? It makes perfectly logical sense, other than the fact that we choose to sin every single day. For Peter, he knew beyond a shadow of a doubt, I will not deny you. I will go to prison, even to death for you, Jesus. And then when the moment of crisis comes, how often do we sit with Peter and shake our heads, not at him, not at other people, but at ourselves. And we sit there broken, knowing. Peter, after he did it the first time, I think he's like, shaky ground here, Peter. After he did it the second time, he's like, don't do it again. And then somebody else just has to ask him the question in another moment of crisis. You're one of them. You're a Galilean just like them. Yeah, I knew that I had seen you somewhere. And at that moment, Peter denies Christ for a third time and the rooster crows. And do you think that the picture was accurate here? That immediately Peter goes to that moment, maybe sitting around a fire with Jesus, and he remembers the very words that he said. And that look, that look. That's in the Gospel of Luke. We're going to read it in just a moment. I like to think as a parent that I'm getting pretty good at the look, right? I've had 13 years of practice. Am I getting better at it? That I can just shoot a look at a child and immediately, poof, you're perfectly balanced, perfectly everything. You do exactly what I'm thinking you should be doing at this very moment, right? Unfortunately, that look doesn't work all that well. But I think if there was ever a look in the history of the world that the weight of one's choices fell so heavy upon his chest, it was this look from Jesus to Peter. Peter is adamant, I will not deny you. I will not turn away. No matter what everybody else does, I'm your guy, Jesus. You can count on me. And when Jesus looked at Peter, I don't know that Jesus was looking at him to say, Peter, shame on you. I told you so, you fool. As much as it was maybe a look of compassion, a look of heartache, a look of someone who was about to take upon themselves the weight of the sinfulness of the world. And that one moment of Peter's selfishness just exemplified everything that Jesus was going to the cross for, right? The heartbreak that Peter must have felt in that moment, right? Thinking back to the last 3 years that he's gone through, just knowing, did I just ruin it all? I'm never going to have a chance to see this man again. I committed my life to him. I've followed him day in, day out for 3 years. Gave up my business for him. Proclaimed that he is the one, the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of God. And then in the moment of crisis, poof, have you ever been there? Man, that's a bummer, isn't it? You're in that moment of crisis. You know, I have a decision to make one way or another. I hear the whispering of the Holy Spirit that I kind of try to swat away like a bug, perhaps. And over and over and over, and it's so stinking frustrating, I choose like Peter did. That's the heartbreak of the Christian life, right? The good news is, being a Christian doesn't necessarily make me a better person, but it means that I know the one who has made me new. I belong to him. He is the one who renews me, who makes me a new person. Unfortunately, it's just so frustrating to go through it so often in our lives, right? To be dragged down by the weight of sin. If we could go to the next slide, how many of you have ever seen this calendar before? Raise your hand if you've seen this calendar. If you have, you probably grew up in a liturgical church tradition. You see in the upper right portion of the screen there, you see Advent. We go through that during the month of December. Then we have Christmas, the time of Epiphany, the time after Epiphany, sorry. Lent, Holy Week, Easter, and Pentecost. Did you know what next Sunday is? It's Pentecost. This is a day of celebration, a time where we as the church get to celebrate the moving of the Holy Spirit among us like we have never experienced before. This past Thursday on the 26th was the day of Christ's ascension, the day we celebrate Christ's ascension. Now we, in our church tradition, don't hold strictly to the church calendar, but that big half a pie on the left, the time after Pentecost, feels to me whenever I see the Christian calendar, the church calendar like this, that those early church fathers, or maybe it was even God himself who was ordaining the kind of time of year that these things happened, that they're like, okay, we got to get all these things done quickly. We've got Christmas, then Lent, then Easter, and everything in. And then we kind of forgot to schedule the rest of the year, right? That's what it looks like, doesn't it? If you are familiar, the term this time after Pentecost is called ordinary time. Ordinary time. Now that sounds very boring, kind of mundane, like nothing really happens during ordinary time. It's not quite that funny because it really refers to the ordinal numbers. There's first ordinary time, which is that time after Epiphany, and second and third and so on. but what I want us to focus on today is that time after Pentecost is not just ordinary time. It's not just boring, mundane, nothing good happens during the summer. It's okay to skip church. It's Memorial Day. Oh, no, you guys are here. Good job. I appreciate that. but during ordinary time, this is the time where our faith that we have grown and developed and experienced during the holy season, that first half of the year, this is the time where our faith gets to shine. Where we're not just being filled with all of the holy events of the church calendar, but this is where we get to take that faith, that knowledge, that experience that has been sown into us and live as the church ought to live. So we need to know how we ought to live, right? Pastor Phil does a wonderful job every single week of sharing that with you, but I want to bring a special focus to this time from Easter to Pentecost and focus through the person of Peter. You with me on that? All right, we're gonna jump through a number of circumstances and experiences in Peter's life. It might be a little ambitious, but I think it should be fun. It's just kind of a narrative, a character sketch of who Peter is and what this time in particular did to change who Peter was. To the point that even today, the Catholic Church can trace the lineages of popes all the way back to that man that we just watched. That man that in his moment of crisis, his moment of decision, had the choice to say, yeah, Christ told me I'm the rock that the church is going to be built up against, right? No, what a failure he was in that moment. But that wasn't the end of the story. You see, if we are going to have times where we grow significantly as a Christian, the unfortunate news I have for you this morning is very often it's going to come in these moments of crisis. These moments where your faith comes smack dab right up against your experience, your life, the things that are going on day to day, week to week, hour to hour. You never know when that moment is going to hit you. But if your faith has not been practiced before then, your faith is going to fall short of where you hope it will be. So we need to be practicing here and now. Peter thought, I'm ready. Jesus, I don't care what these other fools do. I'm your guy. And in that moment, even Peter, the chief among the disciples, fell short. But that wasn't the end of the story. Very often, our faith is formed, our faith grows, our faith crystallizes and comes to fruition in these moments of crisis. The crucible of our circumstances reveal the depth of our commitment and of our faith. And we acknowledge either that I am not in control. I have to rely upon other people, most especially God himself. I have to rely upon other influences in my life for strength, for wisdom, if I'm going to make it through this adversity. That's one option. Or in those moments of crisis, I rest in my own strength, my own wisdom, my own power to overcome, to persevere, to endure through the challenge of adversity or uncomfortable situations. And I make my own decisions, what seems right in the moment. And if I am not in tune with where God is, very often those two paths diverge, and sometimes quite significantly. Alternatively, when things are good in life, when things are going exceedingly well, it can be very easy to forget where my foundation is found, right? It can be very easy to lose track of what God has done to bring me to this one moment, this one place where I have that choice to choose to live for him or to go my own direction. I think that this is one of the reasons that biblical authors sometimes make a paradoxical statement like James makes in his gospel, or not gospel, in his letter. I don't think James was a 21st century American when he wrote, "Consider it pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds." I don't want to hear that, right? It's so easy for us as Christians to sing a song like we've sung this morning. We believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit. He's given us new life, crucifixion, that he conquered death, the resurrection. He's coming back again. It's easy to sing those songs and allow ourselves to get lost in the melody. It's easy even sometimes to read words like James writes here, "Consider it pure joy whenever you face trials of many kinds." It's easy to let those words just kind of pass by us. I'm like, yeah, I did my scripture reading for today. Yeah, I did my worship in the car or here at church for the day. And don't ask that to penetrate who I am at my core. Because there must have been some different kind of context with what James was meaning when he said that, right? Obviously, Pastor Phil, that wasn't for us. There's something else going on. No, James recognized that our faith is formed. Our faith comes to fruition. It crystallizes. It finds its expression in these moments of crisis and vulnerability. And if you can't remember the last time you had a moment of crisis or vulnerability, prepare yourself. I'm sorry to tell you. Prepare yourself. That doesn't mean that it's tomorrow or next week, but prepare yourself means start exercising your faith now. Start relying once again upon the Holy Spirit in you so that when that moment of trial comes, you can consider it pure joy because it develops perseverance and faith and hope within you. And it expresses the hope that Christ has placed inside of you. So Peter declares in Mark 14:29, "Even if everyone falls away, Lord, I will not. Even if I have to die with you, I will never, ever, ever disown you." And Peter said, why did I say ever so many times, right? In Luke, he says, Lord, he told them, I'm ready to go both to prison and to death for you. Peter's faith is tested at this most challenging moment in his life. And unfortunately for him, he fails. Three times he's accused and three times this man is with him too. You're one of them. This man was certainly one of them. He's a Galilean just like them. Three times he abandons his faith and he denies Christ. I don't know or understand what you're talking about. He even began to call down curses. I'm sorry if you were offended at the curse word on there. He swore to them, I don't know this man that you're talking about. We don't know how close exactly Jesus was right at that moment when the rooster crowed. But that look, again, for Peter, I think that look stuck with him. It stuck with him at the very least overnight and for a couple of days, wondering, is that man, I'm never going to be able to take that moment back. The man I had dedicated my life to, I can never take that moment back. The Lord turned and looked at Peter, and Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said to him, before the rooster crows today, you will deny me three times. And Peter went outside and he wept bitterly. We're in Luke chapter 22 right now. If you wanted to jump there, sorry, I meant to tell you that earlier, but think of Peter as he awoke that next morning, the grief, the shame that he felt within him. Do you think he felt grief and shame in that moment? He did, right? I submit to you that the difference between Peter and Judas is that grief that Peter felt. That was a good thing for Peter to feel that. That meant the Holy Spirit still had some sort of say in his life, that even if he had failed in that moment, God wasn't done with him. Still felt the remorse of it, and that's a good thing. And I hope that he would have felt the weight of Christ's death and realized anew, as the soldier did that day, surely this man was the Son of God. Surely this man was the Son of God, a soldier, an atheist, someone who had no history with Jesus, recognized that on that day. And I hope for Peter's sake that standing there before the cross, reflecting on the last moments that his Savior had spent with him, that Peter was able to come to some sort of resolve, knowing, if I get the chance again, I'm not doing that. I can't let that be the last word for who I am as a follower of Jesus Christ. The key question, I think, is this. How did this man become the same person who would stand up at the temple courts and preach a bold sermon that would save 3,000 people merely a month and a half later? Think back to Easter. Do you remember when Easter was? April 17th, okay? A month and a half ago, that's when Peter did this. That's when Peter had this moment of crisis. And then coming up this Sunday, Peter has had something brewing within him, right? Something brewing to the point that he knows, if I get that chance again, I'm not messing it up this time. I'm not missing my opportunity the next time it comes. You see, Peter knew everything there was to know in his head about Jesus. He knew it. Jesus had told him. Jesus had told him that he's going to die and rise again and rebuild the temple in 3 days. And Peter's like, have you seen the temple? That thing's huge. You're just one He had heard all the words, but he didn't understand in his head or in his heart what they meant. But during this time between Easter and Pentecost, that's when Peter had the opportunity to come to grips with who Jesus really was. The same for us, right? The same for us during this season. Let it not go to waste, my friends, so that when you hit ordinary time, that you're not left twiddling your thumbs and like, well, what do we do now? Christmas is gone, Easter's gone, Pentecost, I didn't even know what that was, but it's gone, right? Don't let ordinary time, summer break, the time where it feels like the world is at our fingertips, we have all the freedom in the world to do whatever we please, but in fact, this is the moment of our opportunity. This is the moment when Christ calls the most from us, that he looked at Peter and said, now, is the time for you to step up. And I think he looks at us in that same frame of mind and says, let's go. Peter was moved from his knowledge into a new understanding of Christ through his new experience, the new reality of who Jesus was. And I think there are two reasons for it. You ready to go with me? First, Peter changed through the power of Christ's resurrection. Peter changed through the power of Christ's resurrection in a number of different ways, and we'll talk about a couple here. But we talked about how Peter, as he went to bed that night, his heart must have just been a wreck, knowing that I blew my most crucial opportunity. But Mark 16, 7, when Jesus arises from the tomb and the angel is talking to the women, do you remember what the angel says? They gave it away on the screen. But he says, go tell the disciples and someone else important who needs to know. He needs to know he has another opportunity to chat with me. And oh boy, we need to have a face-to-face because Peter's got a job to do. Go tell the disciples and tell Peter. We also read in John chapter 21, Pastor Phil will preach on it in a few years maybe, I don't know. John chapter 21, after Jesus rises from the dead, there's a charcoal fire that's out on the beach and they're like, that guy looks kind of familiar. And Jesus shows up at this fire. And John's pretty funny. He's like, I don't know if you guys realize the connection between this fire and what happened right before Jesus died, but there was a charcoal fire at both instances. You can go look it up, okay? There's charcoal fire here, right before, as Peter denies Jesus, and now there's charcoal fire again. That's a specific kind of fire, okay? There's this charcoal fire here on the beach, and three times Peter denied Jesus, and three times Jesus says, but Peter, do you love me? How many times had Peter probably said, yes, Jesus, I love you, in 3 years prior? But he didn't really understand what that meant for him, right? Until he had that moment of clarity before Jesus went to the cross. That moment where he said, your love is being tested right here, right now. And Peter missed it that time. But three times Jesus on the beach around the charcoal fire says, Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? But Peter, I need to hear these words. Do you love me? Okay, you've got a job to do. Go feed my sheep. You've got a job to do, Peter. So Peter experiences Christ's resurrection in a very powerful way. Not just hearing the words, the temple will be rebuilt again in 3 days. Huh? Now Peter sees, oh, it's not this that like he rose from the dead. That was pretty cool. But he rose from the dead and gave Peter a new opportunity at life, a new opportunity at the job that he was going to be doing, gave Peter a new revelation of what life could and should and would look like for himself going forward. Peter, do you love me? And Jesus challenges him with the commission to take up the role of the shepherd and look after my people. You, Peter, have now experienced the depths and the heights. And now it's your job to be the shepherd of people who need to experience that for themselves. If you can't remember the last crucible moment in your life, I'm sorry to tell you, prepare yourself. Get ready. Start practicing your faith right now. And Jesus in that moment, maybe somewhere around that moment, as Jesus is ascending into heaven last week on Thursday, he's like, oh, hey, hold on, disciples. I've got one more instruction for you. Last thing that I need to tell you, this one thing. Don't leave Jerusalem. I know things are going to get a little hairy for you in Jerusalem. You can hide out in that, you see that upper room right over there that we maybe had our Last Supper in? Why don't you guys hang out there? Don't leave Jerusalem. I have something for you. You've got a job to do. Your faith is about to be tested again. Let's see if you've learned from the things that you've gone through already. Don't leave Jerusalem, because you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria, but not only that, to the ends of the earth. Peter, you're going to be my shepherd. And now, disciples, you've got a job to do. You've got a job to do. Ordinary time after the ascension and after the coming of the Spirit is not just ordinary time. You've got a job to do. And I hope that we're ready. He has entrusted us with his most powerful weapon in this world, with the Holy Spirit here now. Did you sense him in worship today? Have you heard from the Spirit in your prayer life recently? Whether you're comfortable or not, have you allowed yourself to be vulnerable to the Spirit, maybe even praying in tongues? Oh, vulnerability, that's where our faith is formed. I'll be honest, it's hard for me to release control. It is hard for me to release control of anything in my life. You see how detailed my notes are? It's hard for me to release control. But here's the Holy Spirit knocking and saying, ordinary time is coming, and I've got a job for you. Are you ready to give yourself over? Let's see if Peter was ready in that moment. Don't leave Jerusalem, because I have a job for you. But listen to Peter's words on the day of Pentecost about the power of resurrection. We know that Peter was speaking as much to himself as he was to the crowd, right? He's talking about resurrection and saying, oh, thank God resurrection is a thing. I don't know how it works, but I, Peter, needed Jesus's resurrection. More than anybody alive in that day, Peter needed Jesus's resurrection. He needed the opportunity to look Jesus in the eyes once again and say, ooh, next time I won't fail. Next time you can count on me. So let's see what he says. In Acts chapter 2, you can flip over there from the book of Luke. It's the same author. Acts chapter 2, and we're going to be in verse 22 to start out here. So the Holy Spirit has just rushed in to the room, and little flames of fire have popped on people's heads, and they're like, they're speaking in tongues. They must be drunk. Peter's like, no, it's only 9 o'clock in the morning. They couldn't drink that much. And he starts explaining, here's what's actually happening. Here's what's actually going on. And he doesn't try to explain the fire, because he doesn't understand what the fire was about. He starts to tell him about Jesus, about the power of Jesus' resurrection, which Peter has just experienced to a mighty degree. He says in verse 22, fellow Israelites, listen to these words. This Jesus of Nazareth was a man. He was attested to by you, by God, with miracles, with wonders, with signs that God did among you through him. You saw it. You yourselves know. Though he was delivered up according to God's determined plan and foreknowledge, you used lawless people to nail him to a cross and to kill him. But God raised him up, ending the pains of death, because it was not possible for him to be held by death. A month and a half ago, this is the fool who said, no, I don't know that guy. He started cussing at them. I don't know him. You can't pin that guy on me. I've never seen him. I'm just here for the fire, get warm, have some s'mores. And here, a month and a half later, Peter stands on the footsteps of the temple at the time of Pentecost, when everybody in Israel is supposed to travel to Jerusalem. And Peter shouts from the rooftops, "Y'all killed him. You did it. God was giving him to you. And yet you still gave him over to lawless people to hang him on the cross." Skip down to verse 32. "God has raised this Jesus, and we are all witnesses of this. Therefore, since he has been exalted to the right hand of God, he has received from the Father the promised Holy Spirit, and he has poured out what you both see with your eyes and hear with your ears." He says, what you're experiencing, I don't know how to explain it, but it comes from Jesus, because he's resurrected. He's ascended to heaven. He's sitting at the right hand of God right now, and he alone has the authority to dole that out to anyone he pleases. And that's what you're experiencing right now. Verse 36, "Therefore, let all the house of Israel know with certainty that God has made this Jesus, whom you crucified, both Lord and Messiah." That does not sound like a gentleman who a month and a half ago was scared out of his wits, right? What happened to Peter? He experienced the power of Christ's resurrection. He didn't just go to Easter Sunday service. He didn't just get dressed up. He didn't just take some pictures with his family and do an Easter egg hunt out on the lawn. He experienced Christ's resurrection, and it changed his life. Oh, let it be so for us, right? So that ordinary time is not ordinary time. Let it not be so for us that we are not affected by the power of Christ's resurrection. Well, you know what else changed Peter? Let's look at it. Peter was changed through the power of the Holy Spirit. His change didn't stop just on Easter Sunday. It didn't stop just on that little campfire by the beach. It didn't stop just when the angel said, "Go tell the disciples and Peter." What happened when Jesus said, "Stick around in Jerusalem, I've got something for you," that also changed Peter in powerful ways. And the same change, the transformation that Peter underwent in those moments, the same Holy Spirit that Peter received on that day, guess who lives in you? Guess whose power is manifest in you? Have you given yourself over to the Holy Spirit recently? I don't like giving up control. It feels weird and uncomfortable. And it is, and it should be. But Christ has given his Holy Spirit to his church. Not just to say, like, that's pretty cool. Yeah, power happens somehow. But do you hear the boldness that Peter is speaking with right here? "You will be my witnesses in Jerusalem first." And Peter stands up on that day, and 3,000 people receive salvation. 3,000 people in one day receive salvation because of what they've witnessed, because of the power of resurrection, but more so even because of the power of the Holy Spirit flowing through Peter to give him a new boldness. I don't think Peter was not scared that day. Peter was the same person. He still was probably hot-headed. He still yelled at people. He still's like, "Get up and walk." But now the Holy Spirit has taken what was already inside of Peter, which was not a mistake. That was who Christ had created him to be. But he had taken those seeds that were already inside of Peter and turned them to be powerful tools for the gospel of Christ, for the message of salvation as it extended out from Jerusalem on that day. Peter recalled the words from the book of Joel. Starting at verse 16 here, take a look with me. Here's what Peter said. He's trying to explain what the people are experiencing, what they're hearing, what they're seeing. And he says from Joel, "It will be in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my spirit on all people. Your sons and your daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams. And I will even pour out my spirit on my servants in those days, both men and women, and they will prophesy. I will display wonders in heaven above and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and a cloud of smoke, the sun turned to darkness and the moon to blood." Does that recall a scene on crucifixion day, right? "Before the great and glorious day of the Lord comes, and then everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved." Everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. The Spirit of God in the Old Testament very often is reserved for the special people in Israel. Priests, prophets, kings. There were a few moments that it went beyond that, but it was for the special people. And Peter says, it's not just for the special people. Sons and daughters, kids, men and women, old people, young people, Jews, Gentiles, everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Peter had an incredible sense of boldness in this moment. An incredible new calling that he had received from the Holy Spirit speaking directly into his heart. These weren't just words that he heard. This wasn't just a theology of the Holy Spirit. This wasn't just the Spirit will come upon you and you'll be my witnesses. This was here, now, in your life, Peter. A month and a half ago, you're the fool who denied Jesus in front of him, and the look from Jesus, I don't think was a look that said, "Peter, I'm so disappointed in you," but was a look that said, "Peter, this is the start of a transformation for you. The moment of vulnerability for you. You failed your first test, but I'm not done with you. I've got a job for you. So let's get going. You've got a month and a half to transform your whole outlook on life. You've got a month and a half because not at that moment, you're not just going to be standing in a little courtyard with a few people. You're going to be standing on the steps of the temple itself with thousands of people listening to you. I've got a job for you, Peter. Are you ready for it? Man, it's easy to look at Peter and shake your head. Like, shoot, dude. Cutting off people's ears, falling in the water when you're supposed to be on top of the water, denying Jesus. And we look and we shake our heads at him and we shake our heads at ourselves and we say, man, I don't know if God can use me. I've heard about the gift of the Spirit, being filled with the Spirit of God, but I don't know what that means. It sounds kind of cool. Sounds like something that happened way back then, like fire on people's heads. That would be weird. It's a good thing they didn't have hairspray back then. But Peter says in Acts 11:17, after this issue of the Jews and the Gentile has like really come to a head. And Peter was still learning what it meant, because he's like, everyone who calls in the name of the Lord will be saved, except the Gentiles have to do it a little differently. And Jesus took him again by the hand, gave him visions and dreams, put him in another uncomfortable situation. And Peter relaying this story of Gentiles all of a sudden being able to receive the Spirit to his other disciples and the other leaders in the church. And he's like, no, it really happened, you guys. 11:17, he says, if God gave them the same gift that he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, how could I possibly hinder God? Oh, that's a convicting question, is it not? How could I possibly hinder what God is doing? What Peter's really getting at is he's saying, I could see what clearly with my eyes, what God through the Holy Spirit was wanting to do. It was evident. He smacked me in the face with all the things. Who am I to stand and say no and not give control to God in that moment? Not give control of my life, of our church policies, of the way that the world works? How am I to stand in the way and hinder God in that moment? Peter knew that God wanted to do something through him, that Jesus had a job for him, that he was not done. Though he failed and failed miserably, and his failure was going to be recorded for generations upon generations to look at him in shame, though all of those things are true, through the power of God's Holy Spirit, Peter was able to stand that day and call for change, not just in himself, but in us. Verse 39 of chapter, or 38 of chapter 2. Peter replied, repent and be baptized, each one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you, yes, even you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, for all who are far off, as many as the Lord God would call. Nothing would hinder Peter's resolve in that moment. He was empowered and emboldened by the Holy Spirit. And we as the church, the modern church, we cannot stand and hinder what God wants to do through us, because I haven't felt the Spirit in a while. I haven't relinquished control in a while. I haven't felt what the Spirit, I haven't been listening even, perhaps. But the Spirit of God has a job to do through us, his church. That's powerful, my friends. That what Peter was entrusted with is what we are entrusted with. An ordinary time that starts next week is not ordinary time. It is a moment for us, the church of Jesus Christ, to take up the call to live in the power of the Spirit of God, to relinquish control of our lives, of our church, of what God wants to do in our city, and to fulfill our mandate. I think that's worth doing, amen?